Hello and welcome to Breakfast All Day. I'm Matt, here with Christy and Alonso. Well, sort of here, virtually here. There is a movie called Wasp Network available on Netflix. I didn't bother to see it because I don't like wasps. But it's Christy long. And Alonzo did. Yeah, that's right here. It's long.
But you are one.
I am not.
Are you? He's Catholic. He's not a wasp.
Oh, okay, fine.
Yeah.
Wow. All right. So I've seen this movie twice now because it premiered last year at Venice and then Netflix assured us that it's been recut since then. So diligent film critic that I am, I sat through it a second time. Maybe it has been recut, but everything I didn't like about it the first time is still there. This is from Olivier Assayas, who, you know, I think you could certainly rank as in the greatest living filmmakers category. I think he's done a lot of really extraordinary work over the last 20 or so years. Man, does this movie get away from him. It's based on a true story about Cuban refugees who turn out to be, ta-da, Cuban spies. So you have, first you have Édgar Ramírez, who is a pilot who flies away and lands his plane in the U.S. And then a couple of years later, there is a second emigre played by Wagner Moura, who was like an Air Force officer. And they are embraced by the Miami expat community and become part of this group that flies missions. And ostensibly, the group is keeping an eye out for flotillas of people who are escaping Cuba and getting the U.S. Coast Guard to help them, or dropping anti-Castro leaflets over the city of Havana. But it turns out, well, they're also actually kind of maybe doing some drug smuggling, and maybe they're also sending mercenaries into Cuba to set bombs at resorts in the hopes of crippling the country's fragile economy by attacking their tourism industry. And so what this boils down to is a lot of scenes of people sitting in restaurants and doing exposition dumps. Like, there is a drinking game, I think, for how many restaurant scenes there are in this movie. It's insane. The movie is most interesting when it actually deals with the sort of personal cost of spycraft. So when Édgar Ramírez leaves his wife Penélope Cruz and their young daughter in Cuba, and everyone thinks that he's a traitor because, of course, they don't know that he's a spy. Not even Penélope Cruz knows this. And then you have Wagner Moura coming to the U.S. and getting involved with a wealthy young Cuban-American played by Ana de Armas, but also keeping secrets from her. Those scenes of the couples are really interesting and build drama, but boy, the explanation of how the network works and all the secrecy and the how do they meet off and the how who are they telling is unspeakably tedious. And so, this is a great director making a pretty crappy movie.
Yeah, and despite these massive exposition dumps, and despite how much of a slog this is, I was really confused a lot of the time. And found myself rewinding and going back and rewatching scenes. Also, I had a hard time keeping my eyes open because it's just, there's nothing ever suspenseful or exciting or thrilling. Like,
there's one scene of the guy planting the bombs at the resorts in Havana. I was like, oh, this is actually kind of tense. And then that's it.
Right. And with that, they have like a time stamp with each place he goes to. So that structure helps create some tension as far as like, okay, is he going to get out in time before all these things happen? And are they all going to go off in time? Yeah, you're right. That's the one thing. And Penélope Cruz has some moments. At first, I was a little concerned that she was just going to be there to be like the doting, worried wife, and you know, the one who is put upon and stuck back in Cuba with their daughter. And she definitely gets more to do. And there's one scene where she's just conveying so much just with her eyes and with her facial expression, very quietly reacting to some news. That's quite powerful. Ana de Armas gets nothing to do but look pretty.
Yeah.
And she looks beautiful in her wedding dress, and she is stuck in that kind of role, like the wife who's at home and is worried and learns more about her husband and still has more questions, and the script really strands her. Yeah, and then Gael Garcia Bernal shows up, right. And I was really confused because I'm like, how old is he supposed to be? Like, they've grayed him up.
Yeah.
But I think his character is meant to be younger, or maybe that's just like the questioning he's going through when he's being primed to do his mission. I'm doing the math in my head, like, wait, he was born in 1998? Anyway, well, it all takes place in the 90s, though, like early 90s. And so Penelope Cruz gets like really a terrible perm and mom jeans. No. Like the detail of the costumes and the interiors is kind of spot on.
Absolutely.
It's just, again, as you say, like a tremendous filmmaker. I don't know why he chose this project. He puts nothing into it that would suggest that you are in the hands of somebody with really great vision and really great mastery of complicated material. It's weird.
I mean, I think there's a germ of an idea about like, here's a movie where the spies for a communist country are the good guys, and where that basically, you know, what Cuba is doing here is what the U.S. does all over the world. You know, like we infiltrate, we send in spies, we use the government, you know, like there's a whole thing where they become FBI informants to basically like prevent, you know, different terrorist things to happen to and in Cuba. And so it's all about like who's playing who against who. And so there's an idea there that we're seeing this from the point of view of the communist country and not from the United States, which is always sort of the hero in movies like this. But even the ones in you know, the like, I was thinking about American Made. Remember that Tom Cruise movie where he's flying for like Escobar or whatever? Like,
yes.
Those movies aren't very interesting either. Like, I think anytime you get these movies, they're all about like planes leaving Miami. Like, it just gets, it's not, they haven't figured out a way to make that interesting. And you talk about the timestamp, like, this is a movie where like you're going along and suddenly, boom. 4 years earlier, you know, it's like,
yeah,
oh, God,
right.
Really? And then there's narration out of nowhere. Yeah, no, everybody looks the same. There's suddenly narration because they've got all this stuff they have to explain to you. It's like, oh man, and it's based on a book, and I'm sure, I guess Assayas just felt like he had to cram in that much stuff to sort of tell the story, but yeah, he loses sight of whatever would have made it something that would be an Olivier Assayas movie.
So, Alonso, was there narration in the version you saw at Venice?
I honestly don't remember, but I think there was, because they're showing you all these like other like cells in Miami that didn't know of each other's existence. So like these two people are like, you know, she's working as a secretary and her husband's mowing lawns. And then this guy's placed in, you know, this guy's teaching, you know, conga lessons, but then he's also gets a job on this Air Force base doing whatever. It's like, yeah, I think there was narration then. I honestly don't know what was different. To me, it felt like I was watching this movie again. And I'm sure if I saw them back to back, I could pick out the minor details. But the problems that I saw when I saw it the first time were not fixed in whatever happened in the re-edit.
Yeah, because that narration feels like a thing that was added afterward to make it move better or to make it easier to understand.
Yeah, it only pops up like... to let you know what's going on, even
to
like
sort out the web of stuff going on.
Yeah,
there.
It happens like twice, and it's not by any of the characters in the movie. It's just this sort of omniscient voice. Yeah, this is a real letdown.
Yeah, and then there's like weirdly perky music at times that is supposed to be tense. Like I don't know what that's about either. Yeah, all the scenes in the sky should be very tense because they're like entering Cuban airspace illegally, and taking the law in their own hands, and like we should be just gripped with the suspense of like, are they going to get shot down? Are they going to live? Are they going to die?
Right.
And it's just like people on headsets talking to each other.
Pretty much. Yeah.
So yeah, this is a bummer. I said 4.3.
I said 4.5. Like, you know, I think, you know, the four leads are capable of better. They get a few moments to shine, except for Ana de Armas, who really is just kind of stuck in this nothing role. But yeah, this movie doesn't work.
We should mention, though, that Edgar Ramirez and Penelope Cruz, who played brother and sister in the Versace American Horror Story, are now husband and wife here.
I had forgotten about that. That's funny. And Ramirez, of course, worked with Assayas on Carlos, which is, you know, much better than this.
Indeed. So our number is a 4.4. It's on Netflix if you want to watch it.
If you do, you know, if you're an Assayas completist or something, I don't know. But yeah, I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed. All right. So thanks for watching. Subscribe to this network here. Ours, our YouTube channel. Like this video. Like us or follow us, whatever. Do all the things at BeFest All Day on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Check out our Patreon page at patreon.com/BeFest All Day. Lots of fun stuff there. We're doing our TV recaps, wrapping up Hulu's The Great. We are reviewing God's Own Country for Pride Month, because our members asked us to. Our members get lots of things, so check that out. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys next time. Bye.